And joining us now is Dr. Tony Liachone, former advisor to the Philippines' COVID Interagency Task Force, for his thoughts on the possible lifting of the face mask mandate. Dr. Tony, thanks for joining us. Good morning.
Good morning, Mike, and good morning, Rica, and to our televiewers, good morning.
All right, Dr. Tony, what do you make of the recommendation of the IATF to relax protocols on wearing a face mask outdoors? So if approved, it will mean that it will be optional to wear face masks in open spaces, non-crowded outdoor areas with good ventilation. Is there a basis for this recommendation?
I think the recommendation to lift the face mask in outdoor and open spaces would be premature at this point in time, given the following situation. In fact, Secretary Vergere was against the lifting of the face mask a few days ago when the Cebu LGU or Cebu City made an executive order on this aspect. But looking at the numbers right now, we have a booster rate of only around 18% or 18 million. And we have primary vaccines about 72 million. I think we're the lowest in Asia, Southeast Asia, in terms of the booster rate, while the rest which have opened the economy have 90% vaccination and around 80% in terms of the booster rate. And these are the following. You have Japan, you have South Korea, you have Singapore, you have Brunei, and other Asian countries, while Malaysia and Thailand are above 50%. The other aspect, Mike, is the 11.6 positivity rate, which is still high. Of course, we know that the WHO benchmark is less than 5%. And I'm particularly confused because the president and the Department of Health have made separate calls for the extension of the state of calamity till the December 2022. So to me, it's quite a counterintuitive measure. Here you are, the president and the Department of Health have made separate call for the extension of the state of calamity while we are relaxing right now on the masking for outdoors. And if you look at the website yesterday of the Department of Health, they released posters as well as information as to the importance of face masks, regardless whether it's outdoor or indoor. So it's quite confusing right now for the public in terms of the ruling of the IATF and as well as the movement of the DOH. And the numbers right now in terms of viral transmission are not up to the control. So that's my initial take on that, Mike.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Tony, how significant is it that the president has reportedly verbally given his go signal to DALG Secretary Benhur Abalos? And they had that press conference yesterday to clarify what really is the status. And they said with the OSU Vergere that it is not yet policy until it becomes an EO. So is there are we seeing mixed signals from the government? What should be the protocol? Whom should the president first consult when it comes to lifting a face mask or any other health policy? Is it the IATF in general? Is it the Department of Health? Is it the DALG Secretary?
I think the verbal response of the president might not be founded on solid grounds, considering such a verbal response. And I think issuing a communication to the public without really understanding the situation would be actually be, I would say, sending mixed signals to the public. And I think 2 days ago, I think Press Secretary Trixie Angeles was saying that the president would likely listen to the health secretary, who's our national leader in terms of health matters. So I would say that the weight of the discussion as well as approval should be anchored on what the Department of Health would say. But apparently, the Department of Health and the president yielded to the requests of the DILG as well as the IATF as well as the local executive order of Cebu. That sounds to me like that, Mike.
Mm-hmm. Now, Dr. Tony, in terms of considering lifting the mask mandate, which of the factors should be considered crucial? You did mention positivity rate, you mentioned vaccination rate. Now, if there are certain areas in a country, for example, like in NCR or Cebu, where there's supposedly a high vaccination rate, and if there are low positivity rates in those areas, can that be considered in lifting mask mandates in those areas?
Bert, that's a very good question. I think there are two important parameters that we have to use. One is the booster rate of that particular locality. And the other one is, of course, the positivity rate. As you can see in the country right now, we have certain areas with good positivity rate. I think Cebu is one. The other one is Bataan, and then Batangas, and then yung Pangasinan. But on the other hand, their booster rate, I think in Central Luzon, I think Bataan is number one with 37%. But at least, I think you need a minimum around 50% to consider lifting the face mask mandate in the outdoors. And it's quite difficult to make a decision if the decision will be fragmented, considering we're an archipelago region. And of course, travels will actually be crisscrossing from one side to another. And of course, the viral transmission will not be controlled in this particular setting. And I was expecting that they would first wait, Mike, for the deadline of the Pinas Lakas campaign. I think it would end on October 25, exactly 100 days after the president called for a enhanced booster program. So I was thinking the timing would be sometime like November 1, November 2, which is the date articulated by Secretary Inday Sara of Education, that there will be face-to-face classes in November 2. So I think in terms of timeline, I would subscribe and then give a chance to the local government after we have exhausted all the possible ways in trying to improve the booster rate as well as the positivity rate of the rate. But to me right now, it might send wrong signals considering we're lifting and yet the other one would be trying to enhance the vaccination and booster program of the country.
Mm-hmm. So Dr. Tony, you're saying that at some point we could still consider lifting the mask mandate if certain conditions are actually met. So it's not the case that we're going to wear masks forever, because some of the proponents of this particular measure are saying we cannot just wear masks forever. We have to live with the virus. But on the other hand, there are also concerns that we just have to accept perhaps that the wearing of face masks have kept us safe all throughout this pandemic.
I think that's a good point. I think we need to set a deadline for this one. And since the DILG and the IATF have called, of course, for the lifting of the face, that may be the incentive for us to gun for, you know, at least 50% of the booster rate in the next 2 months. I think October 25 would be a good date, or perhaps the last day of October, and then reevaluate. And I think by that time, with one push, I think we'll be able to lift the face mandate in outdoors. Given the scenario, I think we need to prepare the public, but at least we need to lean on the public safety first, improve the booster, the positivity rate, before relaxing the face mandate in the outdoors. That's my take on that, because it will send mixed signals considering the president and the DOH have called also for the extension of the state of calamity.
Mm-hmm. Now, Dr. Tony, proponents of the voluntary use of face masks outdoors are also pointing to other countries, like, for example, Singapore, who have removed the mask mandate. And the other day, Press Secretary Trixie Cruz Angeles said the tourism department is considering this option to attract more tourists. What would it take? I mean, is this a right move right now to actually consider also number of tourists coming into the country, and as well as the economy as well?
Well, I was looking at the data, the World In data, and they mentioned yesterday certain countries which have opened up and then, of course, lifted the face mandate. And South Japan, Taiwan, South Korea, and Singapore, and Brunei and Hong Kong are actually lumped in this particular higher rates of the booster. 75 to around 90%. So I think that's the criteria being used by these countries. And we are at the cellar right now, with the Philippines at the bottom, together with Bangladesh and Pakistan and Indonesia. I think we should consider first increasing the vaccination rate as well as the booster rate. But I think the booster rate should be one because we're okay in terms of the vaccination rate. I mean, in terms of our primary vaccines. In terms of the tourists, that's another problem, Mike, because we're trying to extend the state of calamity. And if that stigma will be seen in the internet that we're extending the state of calamity, then that would show also that we are actually having some problems in controlling the virus. So that's another thing that we need to understand, because extending the state of calamity means that we're not yet controlled in terms of our viral transmission. I think we need to communicate better because we're sending mis signals. And if we cannot communicate well, then this will not, of course, be understood even by the tourists as well as the local citizens.
Dr. Tony, just to address the issue in the booster rate, will it help if the government adjusts the definition of full vaccination from two doses to actually including at least one booster?
Exactly, Mike. If you look at the website of the Department of Health, the definition of full vaccination is only two primary vaccines. We should redefine full vaccination as two primary vaccines and at least a third dose or the first booster. I think this would actually create, a renewed spirit for a booster program in the entire country. And if the DILG and the Department of Health are calling right now for enhanced booster program to prepare for the lifting of the phase mandate, then I think redefinition of the full vaccination to three doses would actually help out in this particular endeavor.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Tony, let me shift gears now to a new development. Hong Kong has discovered its first case of monkeypox, a 30-year-old man who arrived from the Philippines after traveling in the United States and Canada. What are the implications of this development, the fact that he was able to arrive and move around in the Philippines and leave without being detected?
Well, it tells about our level of surveillance and monitoring. Please remember that the monkeypox was named as a or designated as a public health emergency of international concern, so that we will have a global coordinated effort to educate and to do surveillance of these cases. So I think we need to understand where we fail in this particular aspect, considering it has gone to Hong Kong without us, monitoring or at least diagnosing it. I think we need to review our contact tracings so that we will be able to understand where we fail in this particular aspect. But at the same time, we need to inform the public and no alarm. We should not alarm them, considering the mode of transmission is like close physical contact. And this is not airborne at this point in time, so we don't have to be worried about it. But, transporting a viral illness from Philippines to Hong Kong, I think that should be a red flag for all of us to review our protocol and our surveillance studies.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Dr. Tony Liachon.
Thank you very much, Mike. Good morning.